Chum dun ding gum bun ja gura ya la shan ta lo. Gung ga lu tu dum ni dum dur ni da nam da ra zir vi. Chin ni dum gung chi rin su shir ni ji da gara la wan. Gang da ji bi zor ma ru mun dung ding mar ji zir vi. Ndu zo gung la wu chi da zi ya la tu ji an dung song tu tra chi dung ni mo ni la. Le ji 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 dum za jang ma ru mun zir ding mar mi ga chi ni jum zi ra jir na wu. Ndu ni da jang sa chi da su yun dung li zo jia chi du wu ka.
各位法师，各位佛友，大家上午好。
Good morning, everyone.
我们现在开始讲今天上午的课。听课之前，请大家发菩提心。
We're going to begin now with this morning's teaching. Before we do so, everybody, please make an aspiration of bodhicitta.
因为菩提心就是大乘佛教的精华，所以任何时候都不能没有菩提心。
Because bodhicitta is the essence of the Mahayana path, it's not something we can afford to be without at any time.
所以我们每一天，每一次上课，的时候都要提醒大家发菩提心。
So for this reason, every day at every teaching, I always remind everyone about the importance of bodhicitta.
那菩提心我们昨天也给大家介绍过了，今天也简单的再一次的介绍一下。
So today we looked briefly at what it is that we mean by bodhicitta, and I'd just like to go over this once again today.
菩提心简单的说就是两个决心或者是承诺。
So, in a nutshell, bodhicitta is essentially two resolves or two vows.
两个决心啊，下决心啊，下什么决心呢？首先，第一个就是下定决心，我要让天下所有的众生成佛啊，脱离生死轮回啊，这样子，或者是。再简单一点的话，就是下决心，我要离异天下所有的众生，要这样子下决心，或者是宣誓承诺啊，这个就是菩提心的一半。
So the first vow or resolve is that to seek to attain to assist other beings in attaining Buddhahood and transcending the sufferings of cyclic existence, or putting it even more simply, to vow to work for the benefit of all living beings. And it's this promise or vow or undertaking that comprises the first half of the bodhicitta aspiration.
好，有这样子的想法啊，如果是我们要下这样子的决心，那就必须要有强大的慈悲心的基础，才可以真心实意的宣誓下这样子的决心。否则啊，如果没有强大的慈悲心啊，那就我们不可能能够下这样子的决心。
So if we're going to make a aspiration or resolve of this scope, it's important that we have a proper foundation of compassion. It's only with a strong foundation in compassion that we can make this aspiration in a sincere way. Without a proper foundation in compassion, it's not possible for us to do so.
好，然后呢，菩提心的另外一个部分呢，就是下决心，我要成佛。为什么要成佛呢？因为我要让天下所有的众生成佛，离苦得乐。这样子的话，那这个工作只有成佛才能够完成啊！如果我没有成佛的话，我永远都没办法完成这件事情啊！因为我们目前我自己的生老病死的问题都没有解决，没有得到解决，那怎么可能去让这么多的众生离苦得乐？这不可能的事情。所以呢，首先我要自己成佛，下决心我要成佛。那成佛就是为了一切众生这个决心、这个宣誓或者是这个承诺，就是菩提心的另外的一部分那么这两个加起来就叫做菩提心，就是完整的菩提心。
So the other half of the bodhicitta aspiration comes about as a result of the fact that we have vowed to work for the benefit of other living beings, that they may transcend the sufferings of cyclic existence and attain Buddhahood. However, it is only through first achieving Buddhahood ourselves that we will be in a position to truly assist other living beings in achieving this themselves. If we first haven't achieved Buddhahood, if we haven't addressed the own basic problem or issues of our sufferings of cyclic existence, then we're in no position whatsoever to be able to help others in transcending cyclic existence. So the first thing we need to do is attain Buddhahood for ourselves, and it's this resolve to attain Buddhahood oneself for the sake of liberating all beings that forms the second part of the bodhicitta aspiration. Having this vow and this resolve together with the first one forms a complete bodhicitta aspiration.
世俗的爱心，还有佛教讲的慈悲心，还有这个菩提心，这三个的层次不一样。我们很多时候分不清楚，我们以为菩提心就是发好心就是善良的心我们很多时候就是误以为所有的善良的心都是菩提心其实这三个的这个差别都很大世俗的爱还有爱心和佛教的慈悲心比如说小乘佛教里面也有慈悲心这个慈悲心还有菩提心这三个都当然都是善良的心当然都可以说都是善行但是呢善和善良它有很多很多不同的层次所以我们把这三个要分清楚我们最终要法的心就不是这个世俗的爱心和这个一般的佛教的这个慈悲心所以我们最终要达到的目标就是把世俗的爱上升到佛教的慈悲心的这个层面然后呢把佛教的慈悲心提升到菩提心的层面最后我们要发的心就是不是一般的这个爱心和慈悲心当然这些都可以作为菩提心的基础但是说我们需要的就是菩提心。
So ordinary love, compassion, and bodhicitta, often many people are not able to distinguish between these three different qualities. In actual fact, many people often think that bodhicitta means being kind, being good, having a good heart, etc. But in actual fact, there is a significant difference between the scope of each of these three different qualities. So particularly between ordinary love and and bodhicitta. But even between ordinary love or worldly love and Buddhist compassion, compassion, there's a big difference. Compassion, whether it be in the basic, according to the basic vehicle or the Mahayana vehicle. Of course, all of these three states or three qualities are positive mental states. However, there is a significant difference between them, and we need to be clear that when we are talking about bodhicitta, we're not referring to ordinary love or even to ordinary compassion. So really what we need to do in our practice is elevate our ordinary love to first a state of compassion, and then go further and improve or elevate that compassion until we finally cultivate bodhicitta. So in the end, our goal is this, the cultivation of bodhicitta. Of course, ordinary love and compassion can serve as foundations for our compassion, our bodhicitta practice, but our ultimate goal is cultivating bodhicitta.
发菩提心首先我们要知道菩提心的功德或者是菩提心的价值。这个菩提心的功德呢，如果我们想了解一下稍微比较简单一点的，那就要学汝心轮，汝菩萨心轮。这个轮的第一品全部都是讲菩提心和菩提心的功德，菩提心的价值。
So we first need to gain an understanding of what the benefits and what the value of bodhicitta is. In order to do this, we should study the first chapter of the Way of a Bodhisattva, which outlines very clearly the qualities and benefits of cultivating bodhicitta.
如果我们喜欢稍微了解一下，了解一下稍微再多一点，讲的稍微再细致一点，那就要看华严经华严经里面就讲了菩提心的上百个菩提心的功德和菩提心的这价值这个就要我们就要学这两个就知道菩提心有多大的功德。
Any of you are interested in learning in greater detail or greater elaborateness about the qualities and benefits of bodhicitta, then you can study the Flower Garland Sutra, where the qualities and benefits of bodhicitta are set out in the hundreds.
我想也不是我想，佛经里面讲过很多很多次。那我们一个人的一辈子的这个修心可以归纳为两个我们也可以学很多很多，也可以修很多很多，但也可以不需要学那么多，不需要修那么多，就必须要修两个两个，其中一个就是菩提心另外一个呢就是证悟空心的简洁就这两个。比如说我们一个人的功课每天的功课，比如说我们早上修菩提心然后晚上修空心或者是我们早上修空心，晚上修菩提心，每一天就有这么两座那就已经是非常非常好。
So it's said very clearly in the scriptures that there are two key there are of all of the different practices that we can potentially engage in, there are really two core ones. The first is the cultivation of bodhicitta, and the second is the cultivation of a correct view of emptiness. So if every morning we were to practice bodhicitta meditation, and then in the evening we were to practice emptiness meditation or vice versa, just doing practicing with these two sessions and these two emphases in our practice would be good.
好，这样子先发菩提心，接下来我们讲今天的课。
So, please everyone make an aspiration of bodhicitta, and we'll now move on to this morning's teaching.
还要补充一句就是我们这么多人，可能很多人都学佛学了10年、20年、5年、8年 啊，这样子的时间，那这个时间就七年、八年、十年，在一个人的一生当中，这个时间不是很短。那学佛的时间也已经是很长啊，很长很久了。那但是在这个很久的这个过程当中，我们曾经学过什么？就学了什么？做了什么？修了什么？啊，那我们的这个所学习的、所修行的这些内容当中呢，有没有包含了菩提心啊？有没有强调菩提心？如果没有，那么没有的话，那我们学的根本就不是大乘佛教。
I just like to add an extra sentence before we do go on, and that is that today there are many people here, and no doubt many of you have been studying Buddhism for a long time, maybe 7 or 8 or upwards of 10 years, and this is not a short period of time in our lives, in a human life at all. However, it's necessary for us to look back on what we have learned and what we have practiced and what we've cultivated in this time. Has the content of our study and practice included compassion? Has it emphasized compassion? And if it hasn't, then what we have been studying is not, in fact, the Mahayana path.
还有我们每一个人做一个自我反思，观察，自我观察。我们的心里有没有这样子的这个两个决心，我们刚才讲的两个决心，也就是说有没有菩提心啊？如果到今天啊还没有菩提心啊，这样子的话，实际上这就是等于我们还没有进入大乘佛教的门啊，我们根本就没有进入大乘佛教的门，我们在门外徘徊，根本就不是大乘佛教徒啊。所以呢，我们要以后啊，我们就要去想怎么样啊，这个菩提心从没有到有，然后从有到成长啊，这个我们怎么去做，怎么去培养。首先啊，作为一个大乘佛教的学大乘佛教的人，首先就要考虑这个问题。
So everyone needs to engage in some self-reflection. Have you undertaken these two vows? That is, do you have bodhicitta? And if bodhicitta is still not something that you have cultivated, then ultimately you have not yet entered the gate of the Mahayana teachings. Without bodhicitta, you can't be considered a true practitioner of the Mahayana path. So in terms of how we go about growing our bodhicitta from firstly not having any, then to having some, and then growing it further until we have flourishing bodhicitta, how we go about doing this is something that all of us need to give thought to.
我们每一个人啊，就今天有这样子的机会来发菩提心，还有就是修大乘的佛教，这个确实是非常的不容易。我们的整个的这个生命当中，曾经也没有太多这样子的机会，因为我们曾经没有太多的这样，没有过这么多的这样子的机会，所以我们到今天，我们也看不出什么自己的修心上的成果。如果现在啊，我们不做好准备，也未来也就这么下去的话，那当然我们的学佛是终比不学好，但是呢，实际上我们不一定能够得到什么真正的学佛的成就。所以说这个我们昨天也讲过了，学佛很不容易，所以我们学佛的时候呢，一定要抓住重点啊，这个我们佛教的核心的思想是什么，这个永远都不能忘。
So this opportunity that we have in this life to cultivate bodhicitta and indeed study and practice the Mahayana teachings is not one that we have come about easily at all. In fact, over the course of our previous existences, we haven't had very many opportunities of this nature at all. And it's on account of the fact that we haven't had such an opportunity that in this life we can't see too many signs of our previous practice. However, if we continue like this, of course, doing some Buddhist practice is better than doing none at all. However, without cultivating our bodhicitta, then it won't be possible for us to really achieve true realization in the Buddhist teachings. So it's important, as mentioned yesterday, that as Buddhist practitioners, we really grasp what the core thought and what the core value is in the Mahayana teachings. And these are things we can't afford to forget.
So we hope,或者是呼吁啊，我们的佛教的道场里面就不要有太多的形式化的这些活动啊，更不要有商业化的活动。嗯，因为这个形式化的活动、商业化的活动，全世界的佛教的道场里面啊都是这样子。那在这个当中，我们佛教的像菩提心、像这个证悟空性的智慧等等。这些很重要的核心的部分呢就会失去的，所以我们以后呢每一个道场或者是每一个佛教徒都要考虑一下我们怎么样啊弘扬这个大乘佛教的精华啊，道场的这个负责人，还有就是我们到道场来学习的每一个佛教徒，大家齐心协力的去思考啊这个问题，这样子的话我们办一个道场也是非常变得很有意义，然后呢每一个到这个道场来学习来拜访的人也就变得很有意义否则的话那整天都是这些形式化商业化的东西，道场有没有也就是一样没有什么特别的意义，然后到这个道场来学习的人呢拜访的人朝拜的人也都不到什么真正的佛教，这样子的话其实来和不来最后也都是变成一样这样子的话我们对个人的修心佛教的传播都非常的不利，所以希望我们以后呢就是大家要把这个菩提心和证悟空性的智慧把这些作为侧重点，作为这个重点来学习。
So I would therefore hope, or rather urge, all Dharma centers to not hold too many empty and ritualistic activities and activities of a commercial kind either. If around the whole world these kinds of activities come to predominate, then the real core of the Buddhist teachings, namely bodhicitta and the wisdom of realizing emptiness, will be lost in the process. So we really need to think about this and think about how it is that we can help the Buddhist teachings truly flourish.This is something that everyone involved in running Dharma centers should think about, and if they're able to put emphasis on these core ideas and practice, then running a Dharma center can become extremely purposeful and meaningful, and it also means that people who visit the center will also be benefited as well. However, if this isn't the case, then not only will running a Dharma center not be particularly meaningful, people who visit the center won't be benefited in a significant way, and ultimately there won't be really much difference between whether people come or whether they don't. So whether it's in terms of one's personal practice or in terms of assisting the spread of Buddhism, placing emphasis and importance on the study and cultivation of bodhicitta and the wisdom of realizing emptiness is very important, and these should be the things that we give, these should be the core of our practice and study and attention.
接下来我们将今天的这个主题的课程，本来我们今天是要讲这个往生西方极乐世界的方法，但是这个我们就下午讲，今天上午呢我们跟接着昨天的这个内容继续讲无我空心的修法。
So now we are going to move on with this morning's teaching. Originally, the topic of this morning's teaching was going to be on achieving rebirth in Amitabha's pure realm. We are going to I'm going to teach on this afternoon. However, for the morning, I would actually like to continue teaching on what we were addressing yesterday afternoon. So I'd like to continue teaching on realizing emptiness and no self in a meditative context.
这样子，首先我们要了解佛教的这些修心当中就有两个不同的修法两个不同的方法，一个就是有我的修法，一个是无我的修法。也就是说，一个修法是在我的这个基础上，有我的基础上去修。比如说，我要去发菩提心，我要去度众生，我要去利益众生等等，就是由我自我的这个基础，由这样子的一部分的修法。另外一部分的修法呢，就是讲无我不存在所谓的这个自我。自我它完全就是一个我们自己的想象当中存在的一个这样子的概念，实际上它没有一个实质性的东西把这个作为基础，然后就有一系列的这个修法，那这些修法叫做无我的修法。
So first of all, in terms of Buddhist meditation practices,It's possible for us to divide them into two types. And these two types are ones that are premised on a concept of the self, and the second type, which is premised on no self. So an example of the first would be, say, bodhicitta cultivation, where we vow that cultivate bodhicitta. I vow to liberate all beings. I promise and undertake to assist all living beings, etc. So this kind of practice is premised on a sense of self and a sense of ego. And this is one type of meditation practices or practice methods that do exist. The second is a type of practice that is premised on no self. So according to this approach, the self is seen as non-existent, the ego is seen as nothing but an imaginary concept, not substantive in nature. And there is a great number of meditation methods that fall into this second category of no self or non-self, emptiness practice methods.
这两种不同的修法，有我的修法和无我的修法，这两种不同的修法来自于佛教的另外一种观点那这个观点叫做而敌圣依敌和世俗敌。而敌，佛教里面讲而敌圣依地和世俗地，那为什么叫做圣依地和世俗地呢？为什么要讲这个圣依地和世俗地？因为我们的感官所看到的、所得到的这个结论，和另外一个更深层次的智慧所获得的这个结论，这两个之间有一定的距离，有一定的距离。所以就产生了一个圣依敌和世俗敌这样子的说法。
So, these two different types of meditation practices originate from the Buddhist doctrine of the two truths, that is, two different levels of truth, a provisional truth and then a definitive truth.So why is it that we have this notion of the two truths? Well, the reason for this is that there is a significant difference between the kinds of conclusions that our sense faculties arrive at concerning the nature of reality and that which the deepest wisdom of our minds does. So it's on account of this difference between these two levels of reality or truth that we have this notion of the provisional and definitive.
啊，为什么有生一滴和世俗滴？我们刚才讲过了，就是因为我们的感官去看这个世界，它所获得的结论和另外一个更深层次的啊，更级别更高的智慧来看这个世界啊，它的结论不一样，而且这两个的差距很大，所以呢啊。我们先把这个生一滴和世俗滴分开啊，分开来讲啊，这样子的话就比较啊容易理解啊，比较容易理解，就是为了让大家比较方便、比较容易理解佛教讲的空心和无我，所以首先把这个世俗滴和生一滴、二滴分开讲，分开讲的话。就变成了两个不同的层面啊，从这个层面看，从另外一个层面看不一样。比如说，我们站在啊一座很高的啊这个山的山脚下看看过去，或者是站在这座山的最高的地方去看啊，结论不一样啊，结论是不一样，但是他看的。啊，是一个方向，但是他看到的这个，虽然是一个方向，但是结论不一样，因为他的层次，他站的这个高度不一样，站的高度不一样，所以他看到的也不一样，所以呢，佛教里面就分二谛。
So as we said before, the difference, the reason that we separate the provisional truth from the definitive truth is because of this difference between the way that our sense faculties perceive the world and the way that it is possible to perceive the world from a perspective of higher wisdom. And actually the difference between the two is very large. Therefore, the reason that we distinguish these two levels of truth, the provisional and the definitive, is in order to make it easier to understand or more convenient to understand the doctrines of no self and emptiness. Therefore, we separate these into two different levels. So we could imagine it's like a really tall mountain. If we are standing at the base of the mountain, we see things one way. If we are standing at the peak of the mountain, we see things another way. Even though we may be looking in exactly the same direction, looking at exactly the same thing. Nevertheless, because of the different places, the different heights that we're standing at, we come to completely different conclusions.
比如说，啊，我们用我们的肉眼，啊，看一个，比如说我们的前面，啊，放一块石头，砖头，然后用我们的肉眼看这个石头和用电子显微镜看这个石头，这两个的结论是不一样的。我们的肉眼所得到的结论和电子显微镜它所得到的结论是不一样，但是呢，他们两个都在看一个东西，但是因为他看这个东西的工具不一样，工具的能力不一样，所以它的结论不一样，结果不一样。
So it's just the same as looking at a rock or a brick with our naked eye. The difference between looking at it with our naked eye and looking at the same stone or brick through an electromagnetic microscope. On account of looking at it with our eye and looking at it through a microscope, we would see completely different things. We would arrive at different conclusions. And this is the result of using different tools to look at the object in question, the different capacities of the tools in question. Nevertheless, whether we look at it with our eye or through a microscope, we're still looking at the same object.
啊，这两个不同的结论啊，不同的结论 那当中呢，我们应该是说显微镜所看到的结论是正确的啊，然后呢，我们的肉眼所看到的是错误的，可以这么说啊。但是呢，显微镜也有很多不同的显微镜，所以呢，他们看到的，他们之间看到的结论也是不一样的。所以呢，佛教认为这个世界上没有一个绝对的真理啊，只有相对的真理。所有的所谓的我们所想象出来的这个所谓的真理全部消失的时候，这叫做真理，实际上是一个没有真理的真理。还没有达到这个境界之前，所有的所谓的真理只能说暂时相对相比之下的真理，但是没有一个最终极的真理啊。所以佛教里面暂时先给我们分两个圣义谛和世俗谛来了解这个世界的真相。
So of these different conclusions or different understandings or perceptions of the brick that we might arrive at through looking at it with our naked eye and looking at it through a microscope, the more accurate impression would be that achieved through looking at a microscope, whereas that which we see looking at it with our naked eye would be mistaken and distorted. However, among microscopes there are a variety of different types, and so for this reason a variety of different conclusions that can be reached or impressions that can be reached through relying on different microscopes. So therefore we conclude that there is no ultimate truth, only many relative truths. When, however, all of our so-called concepts of truth disappear, we finally arrive at a truth which is a truthless truth. However, for the time being, until we reach this level of realization, the Buddhist teachings provide us with two levels of truth in order to understand the nature of reality.
好，这个圣义谛和世俗谛，它的这个字面的啊内容是什么呢？圣义啊，圣义的意思就是说真相、真实啊，就是正确啊，这样子圣义。然后世俗就是假想、错误、虚幻啊，假的，就是这样子的意思，圣义谛和世俗谛。
So these are two different levels of truth, the provisional and the definitive. They carry the meanings of, for the definitive truth, carries the idea of truth being real. The provisional truth carries the idea of being illusory, false.
啊，但是世俗谛。世俗啊，这两个字的后面又加了一个谛啊，在韩文里面呢加了一个谛，藏文里面呢也有这个意思啊，这些都是来自于印度的佛教。那世俗啊，后面又加了一个谛字，这个谛字又是什么意思？是真实、真实的意思啊。那这样子。世俗是假的，然后后面又加了一个底字是真实，那不就前后矛盾吗？啊，不矛盾。相对而言，我们看到的这个世界啊，也是对我们的感官而言是真实的啊。比如说我们做梦的时候，梦啊，一个醒过来的人来说啊，已经苏醒的人来说，是假的，但是呢，正在做梦的人对他而言，梦里面的一切是真实的。所以呢，我们今天看到的这个世界，包括我们的自我啊，这些从另外一个更高的层面来看，这些都是假的，这些都是虚幻的。但是从我们自己的感官的层面啊，站在我们自己的感官的角度去看的话， 一切都是真实的。所以呢，实俗两个字的后面还要加一个底，这个就是世俗层面上的真相。
So these two terms, provisional and definitive, in Chinese there is an extra character at the end, di, which means truth, and this is the same in Tibetan as well. The Tibetan terms also carry this meaning. So if, and this word, di, meaning true, meaning real, may seem somewhat contradictory if it is attached to the end of the word for provisional. If provisional means not true, false, and then we add a truth at the end of it, then how can you have a not true and false truth? Is there a conflict between the two? In actual fact, there is no conflict. The reason being that according to the provisional level, the world that we see or the world that appears to our senses as it does is in fact real, is real, it seems very real, just as in a dream, even though a dream is false, when we are in the dream, that is, when we are dreaming, it is very real to the person who's in the dream. So even though the phenomenal world and indeed ourselves, when looked at from a higher perspective, can be understood as false, as illusory. Nevertheless, when approached from the point of view of our ordinary senses, everything indeed seems extremely real. And so that is why we have we add truth to the end of the word provisional and come up with the concept of a provisional truth.
好，我们现在这样子圣义谛和世俗谛分开来讲，所以我们现在就有两个修法，一个是有我的修法，一个是无我的修法。有我的修法呢，我们刚刚讲的这个菩提心是有我的修法，就是我们认为有一个我的存在，所以我要去帮助天下所有的众生。我要去让他们成佛所以我要成佛，我要修心这些所有的这些都离不开我这个字所以这些都是有我的有我的修法。还有就是出离心比如说我们很多的世俗的还有这个出离心，还有尤其是这个慈悲心这些都是有我的修法。那么他们都是从我们的感官的这个结论，从这个层面去看这个世界这样子以后呢，有我有他都有，所以呢，我要去帮助他们，这些都是成理的这些都是准确的。
So, based on these two different levels of truth, the provisional and the definitive, we therefore have meditation practices that are premised on the sense of self and ones that are premised on no self or non-self. So as we mentioned, bodhicitta cultivation practices is predicated on the sense of self, on the existence of self. That is, it is I who vow to help other beings. It's I who vow to assist them in attaining Buddhahood. It is I who engage in practice of the Buddhist teachings. It's I who study the teachings. The same with renunciation and compassion practices too. All of these involve a sense of self. And the reason for this is, all of these practices indeed are ones that approach reality from the perspective of our ordinary sense faculties and perceptions. And according to this level of perception, I, you, other, all exist. And so therefore it is reasonable to vow to assist other beings. This is a reasonable and justifiable approach to take.
如果我们永远都站在这个层面看这个世界这样子的话，那我们不需要去了解空心不需要去修空心，因为这个层面是有我的有我有众生，有我有你都有的，这叫做现实生活。现实生活当中呢， 我们不能说哇无我，不能说无他，那这个就是很小，这是一个小，会变成一个小华啊。所以呢，我们在现实生活当中呢，就要承认有我的存在啊，有终身的存在，所以呢，就有一系列的这个有我的这个修法和修心。
So, if we are going to stand at this conventional vantage point forever, then it is this vantage point and stand at this conventional way of approaching reality forever, then it's not necessary for us to realize emptiness. You, self, other, etc., all of these things exist in ordinary life, and talking about no self and no you and no other doesn't make sense according to this perspective of approaching reality. So from the point of view of those who are approaching reality from this vantage point, it's necessary that we admit the existence of self, of other, etc. And there are for this reason a great many Buddhist practices that operate at this level.
好，这个时候我们通过我们自己的感官啊去看这个世界，然后我们特别特别的相信我们的感官。俗话也说眼见为实啊，我们的眼睛看到了，我们就认为它是真实的啊，那这个就没有人说这不对的啊，大家都认为眼见为实啊。既然是眼见为实的话，那耳朵听到的，身体触觉到、感觉到的，那这些都也是真实的。那我们就怎么相信了我们自己的感官？我们相信了我们的感官，然后我们一直认为这个世界是存在的。那我们的观点，所有的这个世俗的观点啊，就建立在这个基础上啊。如果有一天啊，这个感官的这个真实性、准确率如果受到一些动摇的话，那我们的所有的价值观、我们的所有的这些世俗的这些见解、看法啊，全部会受到动摇，是会受到破坏，甚至有可能全部会瓦解崩溃。
So, using our senses to perceive the phenomenal world and judge its reality, we operate according to the idea that if my eyes can see it, then it must be true. And we take this approach to that which we hear and the other senses, the other information that our other senses perceive.So in believing in our senses, in believing the world that they perceive is real, everything else erect upon this foundation. However, if one day our belief in the reality of what our senses perceive is disturbed, then all of the other values and opinions and thoughts that we have assembled on this foundation may be strongly affected, and it's actual fact possible that they may collapse entirely.
啊，如果我们只追求这个现实生活当中的这些现实生活当中一切，就像我们现实生活当中的幸福快乐只追求这一点，没有更高的追求，没有更高的想法，那这样子我们根本就不需要去分什么生意的、世俗的、有我无我、空心不空这些都是多余的，都不需要的。因为现实生活当中我们很清楚地感受到喝水可以解渴，吃饭可以充饥，而我们没有必要去再观察这个水到底怎么样能够解渴，这个是真还是假，没有这个必要。如果只有这一点追求，那就不需要观察。所以我们相信我们的感官，相信自己的感受，相信自己的感觉，走， 这样子就可以了，永远这个轮回的路永远是没有尽头的，一直都可以走下去的。
So if we are only interested in pursuing worldly existence, joy and happiness in this worldly existence and nothing higher, then there's no need for us to bother about distinguishing between the definitive and provisional levels of truth or self and no self, emptiness and non-emptiness, etc. If in our everyday we rely on our senses indeed it is the case that according to this conventional level of reality that drinking water is able to cure our thirst, then there's no need for us to really inquire deeply into how this is the case that water cures our thirst and to really unravel this any further. Simply believing in what our senses tell us, it's possible for us to continue in our lives in this way without needing to go any further.
好，对这种人啊，释迦牟尼佛就提供了一个推荐了一个方法，这叫做人天乘啊。人天乘它既不是大乘佛教，又不是小乘佛教，是一个第大乘佛教、小乘佛教，然后是一个第三个佛教。第三个佛教叫做人天乘啊。人天乘它不需要证悟空心啊，它不需要发菩提心，它也不需要处理心，都不需要，只要相信因果、善恶因果，相信生命轮回，然后在现实生活当中精良的心善断恶，这样子就可以了。这就是他的一个全部的一个全部完整的一个路，一条路，那这叫做人天乘。
So for people who are content to live their lives in this way, the Buddha in fact set out a path of practice or a way of practice for them. This is called the worldly vehicle. This is not the Mahayana approach. It's not the approach of the basic vehicle ever either. It's an approach distinct unto itself. So this kind of Buddhist existence doesn't require a realization of emptiness. It doesn't require the cultivation of bodhicitta, and neither does it require renunciation. All that is required is that a Buddhist following this approach have belief in the operation of karmic cause and effect and the existence of past and future lives, and on this basis strive to do positive actions and abandon negative actions. And this path represents a complete approach unto itself.
为什么叫做人天乘？就是通过这条路可以走到人间，可以走到天人当中啊，然后他可以生生死死可以享受人天的福报啊，所以呢叫做人天乘。
So the reason that this is called the worldly approach or the worldly vehicle or sometimes the vehicle of humans and gods is because by following this approach it is possible for us to enjoy the good fortune of humans and worldly gods existence after existence.
如果想走这条路啊，那我们不需要发菩提心，也不需要证悟空心，都不需要。
And if this is the path that we're interested in following, there's no need to cultivate bodhicitta or renunciation.
但是这条路啊，就不能解决生老病死的痛苦，还有很多很多我们人间，还有在天人啊。的生活当中存在的一些痛苦都不能解决。
However, this approach is not able to address or is not able to solve the sufferings of cyclic existence, and neither is it able to solve sufferings that arise in the lives of beings at the level of worldly gods.
如果我们觉得这个炉这个追求太庸俗了，太世俗了，所以就不太满意希望有一个更高的追求和更高的理想，那这样子的话就不走人天乘，就走小乘佛教或者大乘佛教，就其中走一个就可以，这个他们的追求比人天乘的追求高。
If, however, we think that this kind of goal is too ordinary and too mundane, it's not one that we still feel satisfied with, if we want to aim for a goal that is higher than this, then we can choose to practice the teachings of the basic vehicle or of the Mahayana vehicle. The demands and indeed the goals of both of these traditions is much higher.
因为小乘佛教和大乘佛教它的标准比较高标准高，所以它的要求也高，所以需要有出离心，需要有菩提心，还更重要的就是需要有真无空心的智慧。
So because the standards of both of these vehicles are higher, their requirements of us are higher too, their demands of our practice. So it's necessary for us to cultivate renunciation, compassion, and even more importantly, to establish a correct view of emptiness.
这三个选择当中呢，选哪一条路都是每一个人自己决定，是自己的自由。当然从大乘佛教的角度讲，他会鼓励我们选大乘佛教的路。
As to which of these three choices we make, this is something up to each of us as individuals. Of course, from the point of view of the Mahayana school, the Mahayana teachings would strongly encourage us to pursue the Mahayana path.
好，那我们现在需要的是什么呢？就是我们要去这个修这个无我，这样子的话呢，首先要知道我们为什么要这个修无我简单的说，我们的所有的烦恼所有的烦恼，贪嗔痴慢等等，所有的烦恼跟自我有关系就因为我们的内心当中有一个自我的概念，所以就产生了很多很多的负面的情绪，很多很多的烦恼。
So, we're now moving on to the practice of realizing no self, and we first need to identify the reasons for doing this practice. The first thing to establish is that all of our afflictions and negative emotional states, whether it be anger, attachment, pride, etc., that all of these have to do with a sense of self. Because we have a concept of self, therefore these afflictions and negative mental states arise.
我们发现在现实生活当中呢，我们经常感觉到很多很多的不满，很多的仇恨很多的焦虑，然后我们仔细观察的时候呢，他们都来自于这个自我的观念。所有的焦虑，所有的仇恨，没有一个是跟这个自我没有关系的，都主要的原因就是这个自我那这个自我的这种观念，从小到大，或者是从无始以来到现在这个轮回当中就这么长的时间当中，它一直都让我感受到这么多的这个痛苦，这么多的抱怨和仇恨。那这样子我现在就是要看一看到底这个自我它是一个什么样的东西，它到底是真实存在的，还是一个我自己的错觉我要去了解一下。就有这个想法的时候呢，我们开始向自我挑战。
So in our everyday lives, we have a lot of dissatisfaction, anxiety, resentment, and so on. All of these feelings and mental states are associated with this sense of self. We could say that none of them are not associated with this sense of self. So self is the main reason for these afflictions and negative emotions. From the time that we were small until the age we are now, or indeed we could say for across all of our past existences, it's this sense of self that has been the cause for our suffering, for our unhappiness, our resentment, and so on. So we need to inquire, what is this sense of self? Is it in fact real, or is it just a confused perception? So we need to get a better understanding of it. And as soon as we begin to do this, we begin to enter into a kind of battle against this self.
那么首先我们要知道啊，我们先去了解一下，我们要去找的这个我，自我，它到底是一个什么样子啊？它到底是一个什么样的东西？首先要确定啊，否则的话，我们根本不知道需要去找什么，我们要找的东西是什么都不知道，这样子就没办法去找。比如说我们的包丢了啊，那我们去找的时候，人家会问啊，你的包什么颜色，多大多小，里面装什么东西，他会问。如果我们回答不出来，那就没办法去找啊。同样的，首先我们要看这个自我到底存不存在。我们去寻找观察的时候呢，首先要确定啊，自我是什么，什么是自我。
So in order to locate this self, in order to gain a better understanding of it, it's necessary for us to first have an idea of what the nature of this thing is that we are seeking to locate. If we can't do so, it won't be possible for us to locate it. So we might say it's the same as if we lose our bag. If we do so, then others will ask of us what was the color of the bag, what was its size, what was its contents, etc. And if we're not able to answer these questions, then it won't be possible to locate the bag. So in the same way, if we are going to, in order to locate this self, we first need to have an understanding of what this self is, what its attributes are.
那首先我们去啊去找去寻找啊这个自我到底在哪里啊？那如果它存在的话，那应该是跟我们的这个身体有关系，它不应该在啊外面的建筑物，或者是我们的比如说植物、动物外面的建筑物、交通工具啊，这些我们从来都没有把它当作我、自我，所以不应该到这些上面去找啊。如果要找啊，那应该是我们的身体上面去找，因为我们把我们的身体当作自我，应该是到身体上面去照啊。那么我们的身体的里里外外有没有我们所想、我们的想象当中的这个自我啊？现在我们要一个客观公正的态度去寻找，到底有没有这样子的我。
So in seeking to search for this self, in attempting to locate it, to find it, we need to establish where it is. Presumably, if our self exists, it should be connected to our bodies. It shouldn't presumably be located outside of us, in a building or in a car or in plants or in trees. We've never regarded any of these things as being ourselves, so it doesn't make sense for us to look for ourself on the outside. We should turn to our bodies to see whether or not we can find the self, since this is where we tend to regard the self as existing. So the first thing that we need to do is adopt a very objective objective attitude to investigating whether in our bodies, inside them and outside them, or wherever, we can find a self.
首先啊，我们去想一想，自我的定义是什么啊？我们觉得。自我，我应该是一个什么样的啊？就是要去想一下这个啊，大家想一下，回头思考一下，一分钟的时间思考一下，然后呢，有几个人代表大家啊，描述一下我们的自我应该是什么样子，至少你自己个人认为啊，自我是什么样子。啊，到时候就大家回答一下。现在大家去思考一下，一分钟的时间。
So, in terms of self, we need to come up with a definition. We need to think about what it is that the self is. So, for the next minute, everybody, please think about this. Think about how we would define the self, what its attributes are. Or at least to you personally, how you define the self. Everyone, please think about this for a minute or so, and then we can have some people offer their conclusions.
也可以大家讨论一下，问一问旁边的人，我是什么样子。
You can also talk about with each other. Ask the person next to you what they think the self is.
可以问一问旁边的人。说你认为我是什么样子
？You can ask the person next to you what they think you are.
好，阿弥陀佛，现在应该是可以了啊！我们看一下啊，其实我们这个从生下来到现在，一直都认为有一个。自我的这个存在，这个应该是我们最最最熟悉的，其实是不需要花一分钟、一个小时的时间去想啊啊，最最我们最熟悉的啊。那么最熟悉的东西呢？也许我们不知道最熟悉的东西是最熟悉的东西是什么啊。所以我们现在啊，有几个师兄想表达一下自己的想法，你们觉得？自我是什么样子？
So from the time we were born to now, we've always believed in a sense of self. We've always believed in its existence. It's probably the one thing that we are most familiar with, and so it's hardly necessary for us to spend any time actually contemplating whether or not we believe in the self. However, sometimes the things that we're most familiar with, the things that we're most habituated to, we don't necessarily have the best understanding of. So now it would be good if a couple of people could offer their thoughts on what this self is.
我们谁来回答
？Who would like to say something？
好，你来回答。你认为你是什么样子？
我觉得我自己就是一个因缘聚合的古玉啊，也是一个假的鬼的。可以行走的厕所，
移动厕所。
我就是一个自导自演的厕所。
哦，那不就是移动厕所吗？
according to this person, the self is like a portable lavatory.
这样子人就不是没有尊严了吗？
If we think like this, then it seems that we don't have any dignity at all.
因为比如说女士们她们都很多香水啊，这个化妆啊，什么这些香，其实我们是借口都流出很脏的东西嘛。
这样子会不会很多人生气啊？
So the answer was that women apply a lot of perfumes and other things. In general, our bodies are really dirty. And Campbell answered, "Well, would a lot of people feel angry at this description?"
我想我们可能98%的人就会说，我不是移动厕所。
Probably 98% of people here would say, "Well, I'm not a portable toilet."
还有没有？哈，你来说。
我最近这个移动智慧型手机已经结合很久，因为我刚结合一年。那我想对师兄的感觉，移动厕所只有他自己能用。对，我们都不能用他的移动厕所。
啊，对对。
但是接触佛法一年之后，我发现我找不到我。
找不到我，好。
So this answer was that the person just before his portable toilet is only one that he can use. None of us are able to use his portable toilet. After having studied Buddhism for a year or so, person who answered the question now is unable to locate her sense of self anywhere.
那以前你还没有学佛的时候呢，你怎么给自我下定义呢？
Before you began to study Buddhism, then how was it that you identified and understood the self? So I used to think that it was very simple. I am here, my body is here, I'm thinking, and therefore my thoughts must be myself, but I no longer think like this anymore.
还有吗？
Is there anyone else?
一个是移动厕所，一个是我就是我，还有没有？
So far we have... Self is the portable toilet. Self is self. I am me.
We have seen this body is false. So we have seen this body
So this answer was that our body is not real, therefore we shouldn't be attached to it. And Campbell's question was, yes, but we need to be able to identify what is this I, what is this self. Could I trouble you just to say that a little bit louder?
We can buy ourselves from our thinking to our body using our mind. So when we are thinking something, when we saw something, we are our body, thinking and mind to react
to the thing about ourselves. That's why we buy ourselves. 那我们平时要去思考一些事情我们或者是接触一些事情，我们都会用我们的思维，我们都会思考，我们也会用我的身体去接触。所以说是通过我们的思考，通过我们的身体的那个接触，其实这个我应该是我们对一切这些接触的一种反应。
宇宙穿
啊，
其实 接触什么？身体是什么？
接触住我在这个环境里面的，反正接触很多事情嘛。那我们的这个自我就是这个思考和这个身体的一种反应举重，是吧？
哦，自我是身体的反应，
不是身体的反应，也是思维的一种
思考的反应，
都是。
哦，好。不要说我有听过啊，说我认为我觉得要这样子讲。
如果我把我的手砍掉了，那我还在吗？哦，那残缺的那个身体还在。如果一点点把我身体都全部都就是砍掉了，那我在吗？应该其实还有我吧，这个我可能是灵魂吧。
灵魂。灵魂是我，是吧？
身体不是我。
哦，身体不是我。那你手，你手疼的时候，你会不会说我疼？那就是我呀。
我是说，就是说，我们如果是要高一点层次的话，说，如果我把这个身体瓦解全部瓦解掉的话，这个其实身体还不是我呀。
身体还不是我啊。那那个时候呢？什么是我呢？
他说灵魂。
灵魂。那这样子，我刚才讲的，比如说你收，这个不是灵魂吧？那他疼的时候，你会说我疼啊？那不就是你把他当做了我吗？那他不是灵魂呢？所以就不能说灵魂才是我，是吧？平时比如说我们头疼的时候呢，我们会说啊，我今天生病了，但实际上不是自我生病了，而是我的头生病了，但是我会说我生病了，我今天不上班了。
因为这个身体是我的身体。
你的身体啊。那你呢？你在哪里呢？比如说是你的眼睛，你的头，你的手，你的腿，然后你自己呢，在哪里呢？
那灵魂
啊。
我也给你们举那个这个例吧。So the answer to this was that if we cut off our hand, then we might just feel that we've lost a hand, but the rest of our self is still there. However, if we were to cut off all of the pieces of our body and ultimately to cut up our body, then what would be left in this situation? Our body would not be there, and what we would ultimately be left with is a soul, and presumably that soul is self.And then Kempo asked a few follow-up questions. So when we say, when our hand hurts, do we say, I hurt? And the answer was yes. Well, if we say, even though we say, I hurt, our hand is not the same thing as our soul, is it? So this theory doesn't seem to stand up. But at the end of the day, the idea that is being spoken of here is that... The self, once we take away all the parts of our body, then presumably what the only thing we have left with is a soul.
那你在现实生活当中，你有没有想到我去开车的时候，我的灵魂去开车，我的灵魂去赚钱？不会啊。
因为我的身体就是很
习惯
性的固化在身体当中的我。
就是。
对。
对，
因为我的灵魂和我的身体是
对，对对对，在现实生活当中，我们没有把我当作灵魂，没有的。我们平时不会说我的灵魂要去赚钱，我的灵魂吃饭，不会这样子的。
Campbell said that in our everyday lives, we, if we take this idea that our soul is ourself, this doesn't really stack up in everyday life. We never say, for example, that my soul is driving a car, my soul is going out to make money.
Maybe, sorry, you said that,
自我就是意识创造的，然后我们的意识有可能，我们的一切可能就是意识创造的。
意识创造啊，先不说谁创造，先说我是什么样子。
So first we shouldn't try to say what created the self, we should try to say what the self is.这个就是说我们这个自我主要是看我们的这个业，我们的这个如果是有这个就是业力就是不好的这个其实你累的你累三步是远的你应该做的你打压不及有的你累没三步是远的你应该做的你打都不及有的你应该做你的名字累给你的他中的你都能写过的
但还是没有说自我是什么呀。
We still haven't said yet what the self is, though.
Since consciousness, if self is created by consciousness, and consciousness creates momentary series of events, then maybe the self is simply just an interpretation of
what the series of What was that? Self is just an interpretation of what?
Momentary series of events.
如果自我是意识创造的，那有可能自我就是意识的一刹那一刹那都连在一起的一种幻觉。
在现实生活当中，我们也不会说我是一刹那一刹那一刹那。
In our everyday lives, though, we don't say that I'm just a moment, I'm just another moment. We don't have a momentary idea of self.
在心智中的中首先我是我父母的儿子然后我是我老师的学生还有我是我妻子的丈夫然后未来的话我会是我子女的父亲
对
然后从科学的角度来说我就是无数的原子组成的那些然后分子组成的一些细胞然后
不懂科学的人他怎么觉得我是什么样子呢
然后你觉得我意思就是说我这个概念可以是相对的就是在座的很多人来说我并不存在因为之前你们并不认识我然后对更多人来说也许我只是一个名字这只是一个也只是一个意识
这些表前比如说学生父亲儿子全部这些全部的表前没有了以后呢我是什么样子呢
我就没有了
好非常好
So the answer to this question was that I am firstly my parents child my teacher's student my wife's husband in the future the parents of my children from a scientific point of view I am an assembly of atoms and molecules so what I am is relative
好最后一个
我是觉得说根本没有
太好了根本没有光就是我
对那是因为我心常住
好
所以不变嘛不生不
化哇很深呢好好最后一个最后一个最后一个
在就是已经深入我们这个巴黎，然后我们在这个脑袋里面一直想说，不管我现在信佛还是没信佛，一旦论及到我自己，知道爱人我比我病了，我就会想到我身体不好。但是我如果一旦进入了那个大乘佛教，也许我这个我就看着很淡，就会把自己这个人生的不看着众生，他这个就是我要服务的对象，他是对象，我应该给他们带来了很多幸福。但是呢，如果你一直在想着幻想自己这个我，我觉得这个我应该看淡，就是说我们这个人生，在这个大乘佛教里面说，人生就是把自己当菩萨一样的去普度众生，为大家服务，这个自我，这个是艺术上的自我。但是你不要说我的芭比，芭比还是我这个臭皮囊还是我的感觉。但是我们有用我们这臭皮囊来服务大家，这样就是真正的艺术的大乘，像观音菩萨一样的普度众生，割掉手，割掉脚，把自己不吃饭，自己攒出来的钱或者自己的那个粮食，布施给别人，这样的自我就是大乘佛学，我是这样认为的。
嗯，好。好，最后一个。
自我就是我们那个烦恼所创造的。我们一开始比如说有欲望的话，那这个欲望就成为自我，我们的这个自我和我们的烦恼都是连接在一起的，分不开的。这样的话我们可以把这个自我理解成烦恼。
好好，可以了差不多了。我们今天花了10分钟的时间，大家来描述自我。那这个我想这个时间是很短，10分钟的时间，但是呢我想也许这个对大家的影响是比较深刻，也许每一个人的心里就画了一个比较大一点的问号。
So we've spent 10 minutes thinking about what it is that we mean by self. Even though this isn't a particularly long period of time, maybe this has created a strong impression on everyone. Maybe it has drawn a big question mark in their minds next to this question.
好，现在我们看看这个佛教怎么讲，怎么定义这个自我，然后呢我们看大家能大家接不接受，同不同意。
So now we're going to go on to look at how it is that Buddhism understands or conceives of the self, and to see whether or not this conception of the self is one that you agree with.
首先自我它不是一个具体的东西，而是一个抽象的概念。
So first of all, the self is not a concrete thing or entity. It's an abstract concept.
如果我们把这个抽象的概念把它具体化了以后呢，然后我们真的是找不到了。刚才我们所有人都说了，但是呢，最后呢，大家都没有说到终点。
If we try to make this abstract concept concrete, it's not possible for us to locate this self. Just now, everyone spent 10 minutes trying to do so, but we weren't able to reach a final conclusion.
它不在于我们的肉体上，它也不在于我们的精神上。
This self is not in our physical bodies, and it's not in our minds.
它就在于我们的想象当中。
this self is only in our imagination.
它不在于现实生活当中，它也不在于离现实生活更远的地方，它就在我们的心，我们的想象当中。
So it's not something to be discovered in our normal life or somewhere far away from this. It's simply something that exists in our imagination.
如果这个想象当中的自我，我们不要去动它，不动它的话，那么我们的现实生活当中一切都是真诚，这个都是真诚的。
And if we don't disturb or disrupt this self, then our everyday life can proceed as normal.
然后呢，我们就不满足这个答案，然后要进一步的去寻找，一定要找到一个具体的东西。这种想法，那么这有了这种想法以后呢，我们越有这样子的想法，就是越找不到自我。
However, if we are unsatisfied with this kind of approach, if we are intent on locating a concrete notion of self, the more that we attempt to do so, the more we will find ourselves unable to locate it.
大家想想啊，比如说我们的同时侮辱我、讽刺我、挖苦我啊。说这样子的话的时候呢，我们认为我们立即听到这句话，我们立即就会火冒三丈，然后特别的生气。
We can think of it like this. Let's suppose that one of our colleagues insulted us or ridiculed us. As soon as we heard these words, we would feel immediately extremely angry.
为什么这样子生气呢？就是因为他的话就触动了我们想象当中的自我。他的话影响到了我想象当中的自我。
And the reason for this is that the insulting words that were spoken agitated or striked our imaginary sense of self.
实际上呢，发生了什么？什么也没有发生，只不过这个说话啊，说讽刺、挖苦的这个人的啊，嘴边的空气当中呢，产生了一个叫做空气压力波，然后这个压力波传到我的耳朵里面，就震动了一下我的耳膜，就完了，没有什么都没发生，只发生这一点。
In actual fact, however, nothing really happened at all, except for the fact that the insulting or ridiculing words that were spoken created a pressure wave in the atmosphere, and this pressure wave then stimulated our ear membranes.
Yeah, 那他的空气压力波震动了一下我的耳膜，我为什么那么不高兴呢？
So why is it when this pressure wave stimulates our ear membrane that we feel so unhappy?
但就是因为我们的想象当中有一个东西，他觉得他在说我。
The reason is that in our imagination we have this thing that perceives that it is being criticized.
实际上他什么也没有说，他的喉咙啊，他的声带。动了一下，震动了一下，然后就空气里面呢产生了一个波，这个我也看不到，只是我的耳朵才感觉到它的这个触动。除了这个以外，没有发生任何的事情啊。那这个声音的波有没有伤害到我的耳膜呢？根本就没有，一点影响都没有，一点破坏都没有。那么这样子，实际上他说的这个话在实际上啊，跟我没有带来任何的东西，但是我想象当中有一个这样子的自我，我特别生气，他在说我。
So in actual fact, what took place is the person in question moved their vocal cords, there was activity in their throat. This caused a sound wave and a pressure wave, and one, not even one that I'm able to see with my eyes, only able to be perceived with my ears. However, did this wave, when it was perceived by my ear membrane, cause any harm to it at all? It didn't. It didn't do one bit of harm to my ears at all. And in fact, the words that were spoken really didn't do anything. It's only on account of my imagination and this imaginary self who thinks that it was being criticized that that is the reason for this anger.
那他说的这些话到底给我带来什么影响啊，他给我他说的这些话啊，实际上给我产生了什么影响，这个真的是需要去思考的。
So these words that were spoken, really, what result did they affect, or what result have they really brought me? This is something that we need to think about properly.
那实际上什么也没有发生，实际上什么都没有伤害。那这样子的话，那如果我认为他说的这些话，我如果我不觉得是侮辱和讽刺和挖苦我这样子，那不就是他什么也我也他什么我的身体和这个精神什么都影响不了，什么都没有发生和一样了吗？
So if in fact these words don't and you know, haven't brought any real result or harm to ourselves or to our ears, then if I weren't of the view that the words that were being spoken were ridiculing and scorning, then wouldn't this lead to a situation as exactly the same as if the words weren't spoken at all?
So, at this time,我能不能我会不会生气，然后导致这个会不会导致痛苦不是这个人决定，不是这个人说话的人决定，而是我自己的态度决定。如果我不认为这个是讽刺我不认为我没有把它当作是讽刺挖苦这样子的话这样子，那么他的这个神博实际上物质上面发生的这些事情根本就没有什么了。这是我自己的内心把它当作是一个这样子的东西，然后呢我自己心里产生了这个嗔恨心实际上就是全部都是自己创造。
So whether or not we are angry in response to such words being spoken is not something that's decided by the other person. It is ultimately decided by ourselves. That is, it's decided by whether or not we regard the words to be spoken, that are spoken, to be ridiculing and scornful in nature.Otherwise, the words themselves, they're just an atmospheric or pressure wave. This is the only thing that they produce. So we can see then that it is only at the level of the mind, or it's the level of the mind that ultimately decides the impact of the words, that it is our attitude, that the attitude that we take determines everything, and that ultimately the insulting nature of the words is created by ourselves.
所以从这个角度看，他说的这个话空气当中产生的这个声波，从这个物理的角度对我的身体没有任何的害处没有任何的影响然后那是不是对我的灵魂或者是我的意识是不是有影响呢根本就没有，更加的没有，这个空气压力波根本就没有办法接触到我的灵魂和我的意识，根本就没有。那么除了身体和除了这个我的精神两个东西以外，我还有什么别的吗？没有啊，就这两个那么这两个都没有伤害到，那我为什么还要生气呢所以这个时候我们就会想到，哦，原来我想象当中有一个自我的存在，然后我认为 他在说我想象当中，当然这个时候我们不会说想象当中，我们实际上分析的话就是这样子啊。这个时候我们的想象当中除了肉体和这个灵魂以外，还有一个自己创造出来的自我，然后我们就会啊觉得他的这个话是侮辱我的啊想象当中的啊这个自我，所以我就生气了。当然这个时候我们不会说他侮辱了我的想象当中的，不会说是想象当中的，但是我们实际上这个意思就是这个意思了。实际上除了这个身体和这个精神以外没有别的东西，那身体他的话一点影响没有，灵魂一点影响没有，那为什么还要生气呢？那不是这个没有别的了，所以呢我们就认为他说的话啊就在伤害我，就在侮辱我。侮辱什么呢？侮辱了身体了吗？没有啊。精神了吗？没有啊。那是什么呢？那就是只有一个啊，就是想象当中的我啊。那想象当中的我到底真的有吗？啊，这样子观察的时候，如果我没有找到这个想象当中的我，那到底他的话影响我，我影响了我的什么？不就是我自己的一种错觉吗？不就是我自己的一种错误吗？嗯啊，所以这个时候佛教就讲，如果你消灭了自己的这种仇恨的来源，等于就是消灭了全世界的你的所有的敌人。
So if we look at these words that were spoken and the pressure wave that they produced when they were, did this pressure wave cause harm to our physical body? No, we can see that it didn't. Did it cause harm to our consciousness? No, it didn't. Well, besides, and in fact, not only did it not, did it, it even less affected our consciousness than it did our physical body. However, beside these two things, a physical body and our consciousness, there is nothing, there is nothing else that comprises or constitutes us. So if in fact these words did no harm to either of those things, then why is it that we feel angry? The reason is that in addition to our physical body and our consciousness, we also have this imaginary sense of self. And it's due to this imaginary sense of self that we feel angry because we perceive these words as insulting and criticizing this sense of self. However, does this imaginary sense of self exist? If we can't locate it anywhere, then is it just a mistaken perception? Through establishing that this is the case, then we can eliminate the root of our anger. And this is why we say in the Buddhist teachings that if we are able to eliminate the root of anger, then it's possible to eliminate all our enemies in the world.
当我们遇到了这样子的情况的时候，我们首先啊，我们的心理的反应就是啊生气啊，然后呢，第二个生理的反应啊，就是啊会顶嘴骂人，甚至是动手啊。那这个时候，如果我们啊稍微能够控制一下自己的话啊，首先就不要去顶嘴吵架，然后不要动手打架。尽量就找一个稍微比较安静的地方坐下来，强制性地把自己坐下来。坐下来了以后呢，然后再通过刚才我们讲的这种方法去思考一下他到底伤害了我的什么，去思考一下。思维比较到位比较深入的时候呢，觉得这个事情特别特别好笑，有些时候自己一个人会笑起来的啊！我觉得我真的太幼稚了，他到底我伤害了什么啊？那这个就是一个非常成功的例子。如果有了几次这样子以后呢，然后再从此以后呢，我们就不会再害怕别人来说我啊。同样的，我们赞美的时候也是这样，别人说很多人说你怎么怎么样赞美啊？赞美的时候我们很得意很高兴呢。 啊，这个时候呢也要静下来，先把听下听完，享受一下啊。听完了以后，把整个享受完了以后呢，再去思考一下刚才到底是怎么他给我了什么，他怎么赞美我的呢？什么叫赞美呢？啊，觉得有觉得很好笑啊。这样子以后呢，我们就知道原来这些很多东西都是自己的一些错觉而已，实际上是没有必要的啊。这个就是一个很好的在现实生活当中啊可以引导的，这个不需要太多的太深奥的道理，不需要太复杂的这些理论啊，这个方法是一个非常好的方法。
So in moments when we feel angry, our usual in such moments we generate anger, and our usual response is then to retaliate either verbally or physically. However, if we're able to slightly control ourselves in the heat of our anger and not speak back immediately or retaliate physically, but rather to compel ourselves to sit down to find a quiet place, then we can contemplate deeply. We can think really deeply about what has just taken place. And in thinking about really what just took place, really what was harmed, did I really get hurt? All of a sudden, it seems so very funny and absurd that sometimes we can even find ourselves laughing. And when we can do this successfully several times, then we will find ourselves no longer fearing others criticizing us in the future. And this is a practice that we can also do when people praise us. So usually it feels very good to be praised. Well, what we can do again is sit down, of course, first enjoy the feeling of being praised, but then actually contemplate what really was being praised. How was it that they did praise me? And again, this can strike us as extremely funny, this sense of self that is, supposed sense of self that is criticized and praised. So this is an approach that we can take in our everyday lives, one that is not particularly complex, it doesn't require much theory, and yet one that can be very useful for us.
好，然后我们刚才前面提到了佛教帮我们分析了我们想象当中的这个自我是什么样子我们平时是怎么认为它是什么样子它有三个特点这三个特点我们每个人都默认了是默认，不是我们去观察分析研究最后就得出这样子的结论不是这样，是我们默认的，我们生下来的时候就有这种概念，我们默认了它有三个特点。那三个特点当中的第一个特点，自我它是永恒的比如说是一个唯物论者、无神论者，至少他也觉得从他诞生到死亡之间，比如说100年80年这个当中我一直都是一个我我们不会说我消失后的我已经不在了，那现在我是另外一个我，那明天我又是另外一个我，今天的我明天不存在，那这些都是逻辑哲学佛教的中观，他会这样子分析。我们现实生活当中谁都不会这么去想的，我们会说我年轻的时候我老的时候，我们会这么说，不会说另外一个年轻的时候但现在不是我那另外一个到时候就产生了另外一个老年人的时候，我们不会这么说，我们会说我老的时候我年轻的时候这么说。所以呢这个我他就覆盖了整个我们的一辈子的全部的过程，所以我们默认了我是永恒的，至少这一辈子它是永恒的，没有变化的它覆盖了100年、50年、80年这样子的整个的过程，所以这是第一个。
So, Buddhism has assisted us, Buddhist theory assists us in providing the three attributes of self that we usually attribute to the self, the three qualities of self that we attribute to self usually. These are attributes, not attributes that we analyze and investigate and establish in this way. These are attributes of self that we give our tacit assent or tacit acceptance to from the point that we are born until our old age. So the first of these attributes that we habitually associate with our self is that of permanence. So even an atheist from the time of their birth until the time of their death, say a period of 80 or 100 years, regards this themselves in this period to be one. They regard this time as belonging, this lifespan as belonging to one self. So we don't, for example, say, oh, my self when I was young was one self, and then when I was a bit older it was a different self, and tomorrow I'll be a different self again. Even though Buddhist philosophy may provide this kind of interpretation, no one in their everyday lives regards their self as operating in this way. So, for example, we always say, when I was young, when I'm old, and we have a notion of self that covers the entire spectrum of our lives. So the first attribute or quality of self that we give our tacit acceptance to is that of permanence.
第二个特点，我们认为自我是独立的，独立存在的，它不需要依赖什么东西，独立存在的，我们的身体，它不是独立的，身体上的每一块肌肉，每一个骨骼，都可以分解的，都可以分，如果分下来的话，它可以变成很多很多，我们的身体上有600多块肌肉，然后一个成年人有202个骨骼骨节，那么这些都可以分了以后就变成几百个几千个了，但是我们还是觉得我不会变成这么多，我就一个，所以我们认为我是独立存在的。
The second attribute of self that we tacitly accept is that of being independently existent. That is, in actual fact, however, this isn't the case. Our body can be separated into many smaller parts, such as 600 or more muscles and 200 and more skeletal bones that can be divided into even smaller components. However, it is not our habit to regard ourselves in this way. We regard ourselves as being an independent, unified whole.
然后第三，我们默认了我是主宰者啊，或者是统治者啊，主宰什么呢？主宰我的整个的身体我的手、我的头、我的眼睛等等。我们以为头、手、大脑等等，全部都是我的工具都是我所拥有的，都是我所拥有的。然后我呢？就是在这个身体上的一个主宰者，我主宰我整个的这个身体，我统治我的整个的这个身体那我们内心当中就默认了这样子，所以我们的这个自我就有这样子的三个不同的这个特点。这个我们每一个人全世界东方人、西方人，有文化的、没有文化的，有钱的、没钱，所有的人都默认了也许我们这一辈子当中从来就没有花过一分钟、一秒钟的时间去想过我到底是什么样子，也许没有，但是呢，我们全世界的人都默认了，我们大家都认为我就是这样子的我全世界70亿人口不谋而合，所有人都这么认为，我就是这永恒的然后我是独立的，然后我是主宰者这个我们默认了。如果我们要找到一个我的话，那就要找到一个这样子的我。
So the third attribute of self that we tacitly accept is that of being autonomous, that is autonomous in our own bodies. We regard ourselves as being the controller of our bodies, our hands, our head, our eyes, so forth. And so this is the third attribute of self that we operate with. And everyone, regardless of their background, all across the world, regards the self as possessing these three attributes. Even for people who have never given a single second to inquiring into the question of what the self is, nevertheless regard the self as possessing these three attributes. So the attributes of independent existence, of permanence and of being autonomous are qualities of self that 7 billion people in the world regard as being true. And so therefore, if we are going to locate a self, identify a self, we should be identifying a self that meets or embodies these three attributes.
好，我们的时间到了，我们今天上午就讲到这里，然后大家吃饭的时候再去思考一下我们的这个，我们刚才讲的这三个符不符合我们没有学佛之前佛教里面讲的这些我们都从来没有听到的时候我们的想象当中的自我是不是这样，我们是不是把自我的这个定义是怎么抹人的大家思考一下。然后呢我们下午再继续讲。今天呢上午的时间已经过了，我们不提问题，如果有问题的话我们下午可以提问题。现在我们准备做回向我们今天听了这个佛教的无我，其实无我现在还没有来得及讲，我们在讲听了佛教的自我然后这个功德我们回向给天下所有的众生愿天下所有的众生以我们的功德能够健康长寿幸福，很快就能够超越生死轮回获得解脱以这样子的心愿做回向。
So this brings us to an end of our teaching this morning. So it would be great if everyone could think over lunch about these questions. That is, think about whether it was that before we began to study Buddhism and hear about any of these kinds of ideas, to think about whether we did, in fact, have a sense of self that was characterized by the three attributes that we just spoke about. We don't have any time for questions this morning, but we will this afternoon. And we're just going to end our teaching for this morning now with a dedication of our merit. That is the merit that we have gained through listening to this teaching on no self, or rather not no self, because we haven't had time yet to get around to that, but to a teaching on self. That we share this merit with all living beings in the aspiration that they achieve happiness and health in the short term and transcendence of the sufferings of cyclic existence and ultimate liberation. And we dedicate our merit in this way.
So nam de yi tam zhe zhe ba nye dom ne ni bi da nam ba zhe zhe.Jirga nanji valong zheng bai, zhibin zho lin zho wa zho ver xiong. Om a hong ban zheng ge zheng ban ma se de hong. Om a hong ban zheng ge zheng ban ma se de hong.Om Ah Om Ban Zeng Ge Zhe Ban Ma Se De Hong 谢谢大家阿弥陀佛